Welcome to the video, everyone. Thanks very much for joining me. Today's an exciting day. I am going to be sharing with you the exact secrets and strategies that I use to sell on Amazon FBA UK. I'm going to be showing you how my students have replicated these strategies and applied it to their own Amazon FBA businesses and have seen tremendous results as well. Now, we're all aware of the opportunity with Amazon FBA, but people need that extra support, which is why I'm here giving you a fast track tutorial guide to Amazon FBA in 2019. Enjoy the video, please like and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next one. So just before we jump into this fast track guide, I want to show you how much have I made today from Amazon FBA. How much have I made in the last 7 days? How much in the last 30 days? What about the last year? I know I'm in my kitchen, I've clicked my fingers, I've changed and I've moved. I wanted to just quickly demonstrate to you, you know, that I make a full-time income from FBA. It is real. It's important that you have confidence in me when you're, you know, receiving information and you're using that to make decisions on your, you know, your potential business. I want you to have faith in me. So as well as that, it's extremely motivating. I remember I used to find it very encouraging and motivating to see others' results, to show me that, you know, tangible results in front of my eyes, it is, you know, possible and it's real. I'm just normal 27-year-old guy, you know, it's Monday today, working from home. So I'll jump in anyway, stop blabbing and show you what we've done today. So if we look here, this is not what we want. So we're gonna go Amazon seller, which is definitely not spelled like that. And let's sign in. So we'll sign in. It'll ask me for an authentication code. So you just pop that in for security purposes and it'll jump us straight into the account. Now we can see here, you'll have a little breakdown of a payment summary. So again, that's my recent payment that was dispersed to my bank about 6 days ago. And this is my current pending balance. So this is what's accumulated since the last payment. And this will continue to grow until you're paid, which is every fortnight. We can see here, today has been 488 in sales. And again, you can go onto your Amazon app. You see there, the Amazon app, I have a lot of notifications there. I do check them. So Amazon app, and we'll refresh that. And we can see there 489. So reflects it pretty accurately. And you'll find yourself using this a lot, but it is very handy to track your sales. So this is completely passive income, right? It should end at about £1,000 today. 500 of that will be profit. And passive in the sense that I work from home. So I don't have any active involvement in shipping the products, in dealing with returns, in storing the products. That's the beauty of FBA, the fulfillment by Amazon. So we can see here, last 7 days, last 15 days, and last 30 days. So quite incredible what can be done passively, right? That's the important part of all this. I wouldn't be doing it if it wasn't passive. So just give you a quick report over the last 12 months. So if we shoot into this report section and we'll put a custom report and we'll just jump to Jan 14th, 2018 and download that and refresh that. 212, so almost creeping up to that quarter million mark, which was my goal. Didn't quite reach it, but pretty close. You know, I'm really, really humbled and blessed and happy that I've managed to get to this stage. And I just want to now, you know, spout out all of my knowledge on FBA and help everyone else who's looking for another stream of income to get to the stage that I'm at, basically. So I hope you find the guide helpful. I'm sure you will enjoy it and make notes, and I'll see you in the next one.
But just before we get into this tutorial fast track guide, let me give you a bit of a background of myself. So I'm 27 years old, based in the United Kingdom. I am a full-time private label Amazon FBA seller. Bit of a mouthful, I know. That's what I do at the moment. Now, that wasn't always the case. I've worked in various different industries. I've worked in recruitment. I've worked in Tesco. I've worked in shoe stores. Following all of this, I went traveling, came back, and decided to qualify as a teacher. I did that back in 2015, and I worked in schools for a few years. Still wasn't satisfied, long hours, and I was looking for something different that I could do online. I stumbled across Amazon FBA, launched my first product back in 2017. I then went on to launch numerous other products throughout the year of 2017, quit my job in the beginning of 2018, That was a year ago. So I've now, I've been running my Amazon FBA business for a whole year. Lucky enough to travel to lots of different places across the world. You know, Bali, Amsterdam, Croatia. You know, I feel very, very blessed to have done all those things. And it's all been made possible through Amazon FBA. Passive income, internet connection, and a laptop is pretty much all you need. So meanwhile, during this year, I've also been growing a community. So I've been able to create a community of over 300 students within my Amazon Superseller Elites course, where we've seen some phenomenal results over the last, you know, 8 months. We've seen students who have launched their first product and seen, you know, numbers creeping up to over £10,000 a month on Amazon, which is just, you know, mind-boggling. I've been so glad to be a part of that process and helping everyone as they're moving along in their Amazon FBA journey. So that's a bit of a background of myself, and I'm going to be giving you today the ultimate best, it's a bold statement, but the best Amazon FBA guide fast-tracked in 2019. So I have uploaded videos in the past. You can have a look. They've ranked very, very well, number one and number two for Amazon FBA UK, but they were quite lengthy. Now, I'm conscious of the fact that maybe you don't want to sit here and listen to me blab on for an hour and a half, so I have created something a little bit shorter here. So a fast-track guide that includes a lot of the detail that I've had in my previous YouTube videos. Obviously not as much as what's in my course. That's, you know, over 10 hours of footage, but I'm going to be cramming in some of the most important parts in this video. So I hope you find it useful. Number one, using Jungle Scout to carry out your product research. So the foundations and one of the staple elements of Amazon FBA UK is the product research phase. And you're going to need to use software to be able to browse Amazon FBA looking for your first product. Now, I recommend Jungle Scout. Jungle Scout is software that you can use, and feel free to go and have a look, pause the video, go and have a look on Google at this software. It's been created for private label sellers or prospective private label sellers to be able to go out and browse products on Amazon and to be able to actually break down financially how much revenue those products are doing every single month. So you can actually see what other people are making from selling on Amazon. Now, as well as that, this software allows you to view the sales of a product, the average reviews, again, the revenue, and also lots of other different, very, very useful pieces of information that you will use when making your decision. Now, the Jungle Scout Chrome extension Lite is $97, which is the bare minimum standard of what you need to go for. You can also opt for the monthly web app subscription, which allows you to use the product database and track various different products. I also recommend this. You can actually run this for a 1 month trial, and after that month, you can cancel that subscription without paying the monthly fee. But you must get the Chrome extension Lite, which is $97. You'll be blown away, right? Honestly, blown away by the products that you stumble upon on Amazon using the Jungle Scout Chrome extension. People like me and you, private label sellers who are making money passively online. Now, you know, a few years ago, when I browsed on Amazon, I wouldn't have even dreamt that, you know, quote unquote, normal people could sell products. They could private label them, put their own brand on, and they could sell on Amazon. I didn't think it was possible, but, you know, I'm living proof of that. My students are living proof of that. And they actually, private label sellers dominate a huge percentage of the market. So Jungle Scout, go and check it out. Have a look at the prices. I have got a discount link below, so take a look and you can get, I think, £20 off your purchase. You know, look after the pennies and the pounds look after themselves, as they say. So with the product itself then, the product is the foundation of everything, okay? Everything that you do from that point onwards is dependent on the product that you choose. There's lots of different criteria, which we won't look at in this video. I've got other product research videos which look at that. But I wanted to touch on one of the main things. So price, you need to ensure that you're looking for the sweet spot. So the product that you're looking for sells for between sort of £10 and £40. There is no real limit in terms of how high the price goes, but we don't want to go lower than £10. The reason for that is because you're looking for a healthy margin on this product, a profit margin, and you don't want to, you know, shoot yourself in the foot and cap how much profit you can make by selling a low value item. There's also other fees that Amazon will charge which means that if you've got a higher ticket priced item, you're likely to, you know, increase and stretch out that margin. Now, you also want to be looking for products that already sell well. So what I mean by that is fairly self-explanatory, right? We don't want to find products that aren't doing well. We want to latch onto the back of success stories. So you can see products on Amazon UK using the Jungle Scout Chrome extension, and you can actually home in on the products that you see opportunity with and that you see are already making, you know, considerable monthly sales. They have been consistently, and we use software to free software to check that, and you want to, you know, actually pull out opportunity from a situation that's already presented itself to you as a success. So follow products that are already doing well. Stay away from any products that you think, you know, I might be able to bring out something, you know, that will do really well, but the evidence on Amazon shows that actually all of the products for that niche or for that category just aren't really very high in demand and they're not good sellers. So bear that in mind. So another thing that you're going to want to consider is the type of product you choose and the restrictions that are applied to that product itself. Now, Amazon have thousands, hundreds of thousands of products that sell on their marketplace, some of which are restricted, some of which aren't. Now, there's easy ways to find out if a product is restricted. You can use a software that actually Amazon provide where you can search for a product ASIN and establish whether or not that product has any restrictions. I would advise for a first product, so the first time you're ever launching, to try and steer clear from these sorts of products. You know, we want an easy, smooth ride for the first. You don't necessarily have to, you know, go in all guns blazing looking for, you know, restricted products, even if they do show potential. If you can opt for something slightly easier to launch, I would go for that. Again, you can contact Amazon FBA, create an individual seller account, which is free, and you can inquire with them about a particular product and the restrictions that it may or may not have. When you are selecting your first product and you're doing your product research, you need to factor in product reviews. Product reviews are one of three, in my opinion, major components of a listing and something that will really influence that buyer's decision as to whether they're going to buy the product or not. You know, we look for listings, generally speaking, 4 stars out of 5 or more. Also, the quantity of reviews is very important. Now, what I mean by that is when you're looking at, let's say, page one results using the Chrome extension that we talked about previously, and you're looking at 10 listings on the first page, ideally, you want to be looking for niches and categories that have an overall average review count of less than 100, ideally. Now, the reason for that is when you launch a product, you're likely to have little reviews, and you don't want there to be a huge gap between yourself and the people that you're competing against. So if you've got 10 reviews and you're competing against an established seller that's got 40 reviews, you can quite easily differentiate, launch a product that's quite a bit better, and you can compete with that listing easily, and you can take a proportion of their sales away and generate revenue for yourself. Now, if you were to choose a very, very competitive product that's, let's say, for example, the first 10 listings on the first page have got 1,000 plus reviews, you could imagine you're seeing a little old me sitting there with 10 reviews. You're going to find it much more difficult to compete with these listings. So we always have to factor in review count and make sure that we take that into consideration. I've launched products, again, students launch products that compete with higher reviewed items that are already selling, but we do always vet the products and make sure that we go for an overall rating, like I said, of less than 100, 110 to enable you to compete with those listings. Next thing you need to consider will be actually checking whether or not the seller is private label or whether or not it's sold by Amazon or it's a big brand. We only want to be basing our results on private label sellers rather than looking at big brands and Amazon themselves and seeing, you know, tremendous figures and thinking, wow, you know, I want a piece of that pie. We need to avoid them. Look for FBA sellers on the right side of the screen on Jungle Scout. You will see, using the Chrome extension, it will filter out FBA, FBM, and AMZ, which is Amazon. We only want to focus on private label. Private label are third-party sellers like me and you selling on Amazon. That's who we want to base the results and our decisions on. You know, let me give you an example. If you're looking at a pair of Nike socks and you think, wow, they're doing tremendous numbers, £20,000 a month, I'm going to launch a pair of socks and think that it's going to do as well as the Nikes, you're going to be wrong. Because as you can imagine, they've got their own websites, their own marketing companies that spend millions of pounds on their brand annually. And you're not going to be able to compete with that and the interest that they generate off of Amazon that comes onto Amazon, onto the platform and buys those socks. Whereas if you found a pair of white private label socks, someone just, you know, made the brand up themselves like we do, that would be a much more sensible idea to base your product decision on. Next, one of the most important, which is finding the opportunity and differentiating from the competition. Now, don't get me wrong. If you launch a product that's very similar to someone else's, right? They've got low reviews, you know, the images can be improved on, you believe your product, you know, looks better and is better, you can swoop in there and you can launch with the right strategy and do very, very well. But I'm not all about just doing well. I want to excel with whatever I'm doing. And I want anyone who's watching these videos to do the same thing. So as well as the fact as we can just duplicate what's on there already with a very similar listing with your own private label, I want you to look for opportunity with a product. Differentiate, make your product different, make it stand out, create a unique selling point or a USP. You know, I always tell my students, put yourself in the customer's shoes. So what are they looking for when they buy the product in particular that you're looking at? What are they looking for? And sit down and brainstorm. Well, currently on the marketplace, you know, although they've got this product, there's something that's missing. You know, the customer will want this additional item or this additional feature added to the product because it reflects what they're looking for. Now, I've done this on numerous occasions. I'll give you an example. Imagine a baby towel, so a little white towel that you use to dry a baby when it comes out of the bath. Now, about 3 years ago, the hooded towels that mothers can buy now and they can strap them around their neck and they can scoop the baby up inside and put a hood over the baby, they took off. And when I mean took off, I mean they were doing over £50,000 a month each listing on Amazon.us or Amazon in the United States of America. Now, they're just two towels, right? But the second one has solved a problem. It's identified a need and a want for something. And it's the same fabric, right? It costs the same amount of money to make, maybe slightly different, but they charge almost triple the amount of money for that towel than the basic bog standard one. So they looked at that, that product and thought, well, there's going to be a lot of mothers buying this product, drying their babies. Well, this doesn't really cater for that need. So let's bring something to market that's better. Now, there are lots of ways to differentiate. You don't have to come up with something completely different. You can differentiate through product imagery, better images. You can differentiate through bundling, which means having two items in one package and selling them as two. So you stand out from competition that way. You can also create variations, so different colors or sizes of your product, which also is very, very effective. You can differentiate through price, lots of different things. And we go into that in extreme detail in my Superseller Elites course. But that's sort of a skimming over the top idea of how to do it. And finally, profitable products. Right, we don't want to sell a product for £20 and make no profit on it. Right? It doesn't matter whether we sell 100 units a day or 1,000 units a day, we make no money. So it defeats the purpose of the whole business model. Right? We're looking at this as a financial opportunity to invest in Amazon FBA and have a return, a profitable business. So as such, we need to be looking for profitable products. Now, I advise with students to shoot for 30% plus, so 30 or more percent in terms of the sale price of the item. So if you're selling a product for £20, you'll be looking to try and achieve a £6 profit on that sale. Any less than that and you'll be getting into difficulties. You know, we want to make sure you've got a good return, a good ROI on the investment. So 30% is realistic, it's achievable. I shoot personally for about 50 with what I'm selling, and students I've ranged from 25 right the way up to sort of 60, I think is the highest that I've seen, you know, which is huge. 60% margin is big, but it's achievable. Now, you can calculate these margins using the FBA calculator. There are fees that you incur on Amazon that you just need to basically bear in mind when you're calculating your different costs that you're gonna have and also the sale price of your items. So make sure that you bear that in mind. So moving on to section two, you found your product, your private label product, and you're now looking to source it. So where do you go? How do you get this product up onto Amazon FBA UK? Well, I like to use a website called Alibaba. Now, Alibaba is the gateway to the Chinese manufacturing industry. It allows you to have access to suppliers and manufacturers who sell, you know, tremendous amount of products on Amazon UK, and you can source the product, sample it, and get it sent over to the UK and into Amazon FBA. So when we're looking for suppliers, what do we look for? Well, firstly, we want to make sure they are professional. Ways to do this is to open up a dialogue with them. What's the feel you get from them when they, you know, when they're engaging in dialogue with you? How do they sound? Does it sound like a professional company that's responding, or does it sound like an individual just on their phone responding? So, you know, just get an idea just through a dialogue of how they come across. You can also look at how long they've been selling. So, have they been selling for, 6 months, for 2 years, or for 5 years or more? I generally like to go for 3 years or more to make sure they've got a good sales history and they've got good rapport with their customers. Reviews as well. You can see reviews from suppliers, customers on Alibaba. So you can have a read of those. And again, does it sound like they are providing the service or the product that they are claiming to? And reviews are a good way to establish that. Secondly, we want to make sure that our supplier and the actual transaction itself is safe. So more things to look for with the supplier is that they are a gold supplier, which is very, very important. Also, trade assurance should be something that is considered. Trade assurance protects your order. So if you place, for example, a $1,000 order for 200 units, then you have full protection, like insurance you have on a car, you have full protection on that order. So if it gets shipped over and the product quality is not as it should be, you're protected for a period of time after that delivery. So it gives you a chance to assess the products and check their quality. I've never seen anyone use trade assurance out of the 300 students that I've got. No one's ever had a problem with the units, but it's always good for peace of mind to have those there. And that's something that I adhere to no matter what. You also need to have a well-written, well-structured email template. Now, the email template is what you're going to use to initiate contact with the supplier themselves. I actually provide an email template within my course, so students can use that to contact the supplier themselves and engage in that dialogue with them. You want to make sure that you come across professional as a prospective buyer, even a business, because again, many of you will be setting up a limited company for this venture. So you are a business and you need to, act appropriately. You want to make sure that you get as much information from these suppliers as you can. I always like to ask, what is their minimum order quantity and what are the different prices for the order quantities that they provide? So there's often a different price for 200 units than there would be for 500 units, because economies of scale, the more you buy, the lower the price goes. So always ask those questions. You always want to ask as well that they are OEM, so it's private labeling. Ensure that it's private label products that they are providing. So the opportunity for you to brand them. So white label, they've got nothing on them, but the supplier is able to put your private label brand on there for you. Something that's very, very important. You also need to make sure that you are sampling these products. So once you've vetted the supplier, you've discussed and negotiated a price for X amount of units, you're happy, you then don't just place an order, you always want to sample the product. You want to see it, put it through the motions, test that it is functioning how it should. Always sample no matter what. It only costs between sort of $30 and $50 to get a sample over. Express delivery usually comes within 5 to 7 working days. So something that you should definitely consider before placing a larger order for 200 or 300 units. You should always consider the platform or medium that you're going to use to communicate with the supplier. So although the first contact is usually through Alibaba, once you open up that dialogue, I always try to get their WhatsApp phone number so you can use that app to contact them, any time of day, and you seem to get typically a faster response. And it is quite annoying, when you're waiting for an email back on Alibaba, you've got to sign in. I like to add them on WhatsApp. Once you you know that you're going to be using them as a supplier, they'll be more than happy to give you the WhatsApp number, and then you can contact them far easier. Let's say you want to make a small change to one of your products, you could then drop them a message or a voice note so they could get that much quicker. So once you have your product ready, you need to decide what shipping method you're going to use to get the product to Amazon FBA. I would always advise to ship by air opposed to sea. Shipping by air is faster and it overall works out better. So that is what I've always opted for personally, and students always tend to go for that option as well. Secondly, the delivery method, I tend to use DDP, which means delivery duty paid. So what that means is the actual supplier themselves are fully responsible for that product from the moment it's shipped from them until it gets to Amazon FBA or to you if you wanted to get the products to your house first to check over them. So you want to put the onus and the responsibility over onto the supplier, and they can deal with the delivery in its entirety. You have no involvement. They even pay the VAT and the duty when they come into the country, and they just charge you for that when you pay the price on Alibaba. So it just saves you having to go through, jump through the hoops and get that done when they're coming in. So always ask for DDP if possible. Finally, I would always suggest asking for a commercial invoice. They can come in handy. Amazon sometimes ask for an invoice of your product to make sure that they are legitimate and they are authentic from a manufacturer. So I would always advise just making sure that it's a commercial invoice that you get that stipulates whether you've used DDP or not, for example. And if you paid for your VAT and duty, make sure that it's on that invoice and that it's stamped by the company, so you've got proof that you know you have paid for that when it comes in to the UK. So you will find that some companies provide pro forma invoices, which is sort of in advance invoices when you haven't paid yet. We don't want those. We want to make sure that we have commercial invoices. Moving on to section three, adding value, a very, very important section of this fast track guide. Now I want you to think like the customer. When you are, you know, creating your listing, designing exactly what you're going to be, you know, putting up and you're going to be displaying on Amazon, you need to make sure that you are answering a question that the customer is asking when they come onto your listing and look to buy your product. So you're looking to add value to that listing, okay? If you have a unique selling point for your product, make sure that your listing reflects that. Put yourself in the shoes of the purchaser or the buyer. What are they looking for when they come onto Amazon and come onto your listing? Because that's your opportunity, right? That's your time to shine. When they're looking at your listing, they're browsing through everything, that is your time to actually show them what the product offers in its entirety. And you know, you want them to ultimately click that add to basket button, and that's the opportunity that you've got to do that. So put yourself in your customer's shoes, think about what they're looking for when they come to the listing, and make sure that it's there on your landing page. One thing you need to make sure is that your product is private labeled. Now I've already discussed this previously within this fast track guide, but you need to make sure that it's private labeled either on the outer packaging or on the product itself. Now when you're selling on Amazon, you have your product images, you need your private label logo to be on those images. That distinguishes you from other sellers on the platform, and again, it allows you to create a brand around that private label. It also protects you. If you trademark that private label, which is what I've done, it protects you against hijackers and people who can try and sell the same product as you, because they can't do that if you have a branded private label product, because they haven't got that same product to sell. It's yours. You created it. You came up with it. So just be sure to make certain of that when you are launching on Amazon. Next, we're going to look at negative reviews. So you can actually look at your competitors' listings and scroll down, look at their reviews, and see what customers have been finding an issue with the product, right? Solve a problem, what we've been looking at before. You can actually see within the industry, within the niche, what seems to be the problem, what seems to be missing from that particular product. What can you improve on? And one way of finding out, finding this, you know, answering this question and finding out what those points are is by checking the evidence, right? There's evidence on Amazon, feedback from customers for products about, you know, it didn't include this, it didn't include that, this broke, this part was faulty. You can improve on that, and again, emphasize that within your listing. Now, moving on to this point, optimizing your listing, you know, that's a broad term and, you know, encompasses a huge amount of information, something that I would never be able to go into, you know, extensive detail here, because I'd be here for sort of 4 hours, but I will give you an insight into listing optimization. Now, listing optimization basically just means, you know, in simple terms, making your listing as good as it can be, making it optimized for sales. So making sure that you have all the different components of a listing, for example, imagery, product description, features and details, reviews, price, back-end keywords, Amazon PPC, making sure that all of those different variables are all fine-tuned so that your listing is going to excel and it's going to create momentum and as a result, gain sales for you when you're on Amazon. So optimizing your listing can be done in numerous ways. Again, it depends what aspect you're looking at. You'll need to do research into that to make sure that you have, you know, got every single little point where it needs to be. Let me give you an example of that. So keywords would be one part of your listing and something that you can optimize. So if you're selling, let's say for example, a coffee cup like this, right? If you're selling a coffee cup, I might have a sip actually whilst we're on topic. So if you're selling a coffee cup, when you create your listing, you will have a title, and that title is likely to have the word coffee cup in it, right? You might have transparent coffee cup for the workplace, for example. Now, in your back-end search terms, which is on the back end of that listing that you can access in your Amazon account, you would have a multitude of relative search terms to the word coffee cup. To make sure that when your listing is finished and it's live on Amazon, when your customers are typing in, you know, keywords we call them, so when they're searching for, you know, transparent coffee cups, that your listing is shown in the results for that keyword. So Amazon are only able to match, you know, your listing to a customer search terms if you've got those keywords in your back end or somewhere in the listing itself. Now, as customers search and your listing seems to keep cropping up, once a purchase happens, Amazon makes the link between the product and the search term, and then they make an informed decision that, oh, okay, well, this customer's looking for a transparent coffee cup. This listing, they bought the product that's on this listing. So for that search term, we're gonna rise that product up the ranks because it's clearly something that the customer is looking for. So optimizing keywords is very, very important, making sure you haven't got too many so they're redundant, making sure that you've got as many synonyms and variations of keywords as you can, making sure that you use, you know, tools like merchant words to be able to find out the high volume search terms and secondary search terms that you can use to rank for on Amazon. Ultimately, that's what we're all trying to do, is organically rank for search terms. Next, optimizing photography, or just, I wanted to touch on this point, you know, whether you use the word optimize or not, I cannot emphasize how important product photography is. One of three important points, I mentioned reviews was one, price is the second, product photography is the third. You want to make sure you've got high definition images, zoomable, which, you know, if you've got the HD and the pixels are, big enough, length by width, you will be able to zoom. We want to make sure that you've got as much information without crowding the images as you can within your product images. People will often not even bother looking through your product description and read all of the mumbo jumbo that you've got there. They will look at the listing, look at the images, you know, if you're buying a pair of earphones, for example, you know, listing one would be a picture of the earphone, listing two would be a picture of the earphone outside on a rainy day, showing that it's waterproof. Picture three would be the earphone split up from a point of view where you could see the internal sort of mechanisms within the earphone, what's the quality like of the sound, what technology is used within the earphone, how long is the actual lead on the earphone itself. So you want to answer as many questions as you can within the product images. I cannot emphasize enough how important it is to have top quality imagery. You can get this done super cheap on Fiverr, doesn't cost much. You use freelancers to do this, and you really, really must bear that in mind. Don't ever launch a product with substandard imagery. I have students who have done that and they don't sell very well, and immediately after swapping the images over for enhanced HD images that have been, you know, tweaked and optimized, sales start to increase. Next, descriptive and well-written bullet points. Now, again, this is really, really important. This is another opportunity for you to embed lots of keywords that are related to your product in your listing or within your listing. So be sure to make sure that the listing is well-written, there's no spelling mistakes, it flows nicely, rolls off the tongue, put some time into it, right? Create a user experience. Make sure that you use the space that's allocated for the description and the features and details. Try not to sort of blab on. I can tend to do that, blab on a bit. Try and condense it into the most important information that you have using the keywords that you've got, and fill that space up with as much information that's relative to the product as you can. Finally, follow-up emails. So another way to add value and create a positive customer experience, and another way to gain reviews, is to sign up to software like Zonmaster or Feedback Genius and have a systematic and sort of structured email sequence follow-up service for your product. So, sort of when the customer buys the product, that you send an automated email that says, thank you so much for your purchase. Let us know if there are any problems with the order. You then have a second automated email that would go out after day three that would say, how are you getting on with your product? Do you need any help understanding how it works? And then on the third occasion, you would follow up and ask for a product review. Now, the customer, in most instances, appreciates that support. I've had lots of comments within my seller feedback section of my Amazon Seller Central on that, and I believe it's very important, and it also gets you those all important reviews, so be sure to use that. It's very easy to set up. It costs as little as £15 a month, and you can integrate that into your Seller Central and automate everything, because again, you don't want to be sitting there every day sending out boring emails to your customers. You pre-write it using email templates, and then you send that to the customer through the software that I just suggested. So moving on to the final section, which is your launch strategy. You've put in all the hard work, you've built the foundations, you have selected a profitable product, you've sourced that product, it's been shipped over to Amazon FBA, the fulfillment center in the UK, your listing is created and has been optimized, and you're about to launch, right? Very exciting. I've been through it myself, on a number of occasions, and I've supported students through this process, and it's just very, very exciting. So you can look forward to this if you're going to take action and move with your first FBA product. But you must make sure you've got a strategy in place. You need to know what you're doing in order to make that product a success. You can have a fantastic product and have done everything right up until this point, and it can still go wrong at this stage. So make notes on this if you can, and try and absorb what I'm saying. So firstly, you want to, and just as a starting point, we can manipulate this amount later on, but you want to start with about £10 per day spent on Amazon PPC. So Amazon PPC, pay-per-click advertising, is Amazon's own option for advertising on their platform. Essentially, what it means is that when someone clicks on an ad that you run, you will pay for that click. So when you search the search engine on Amazon for a product, let's say a coffee cup, you'll see sometimes at the top or in the middle or the bottom of the search results, sponsored ads. Now that counts as an impression, so it's just there. The seller doesn't pay for the product to be shown, but when someone clicks on that thumbnail and that listing, you will then pay for that click. And I won't go into depth into PPC and the actual mechanics of it now, but just explain that that's what you're gonna have to use. So run an automatic campaign. There's two types, manual and automatic. We're gonna run an auto campaign to begin with at a budget of £10 per day, and then we can reevaluate that in a few weeks' time and start to make some changes to increase those sales. So as well as Amazon's internal advertising system, you can also use Facebook ads, right? You can use very targeted Facebook advertisements to drive traffic from Facebook to your Amazon listing. Now, as a launch strategy, I've seen this work quite well. You can get a lot of traffic, or we call it traffic, I mean people who are diverted from Facebook straight onto your listing, and you can target people who have interests or who have shown interest on Facebook with your product. So, for example, if you were selling a tent, you could target individuals from a certain age bracket who are interested in camping or interested in traveling or who have been traveling. So you can really home in on the sort of people that you believe are the type of customers who will purchase your product. You're not just putting it out there for anyone. So you really can target those people using Facebook ads, and I've seen them prove very effective. Thirdly, you should drop your price for your launch. Now, I do believe this. I believe it works very, very well. So if you're selling a product for $19.99, and most of the competition is selling between sort of $18.99 and $23.99, your plan is to go in at $19.99. That's what you've worked your margins out at. I suggest dropping that price so you are the lowest on the first page. Now, the reason for that, even though you will lose some of your margin, your profit margin, it will help with ranking. So your main goal for your first batch of products is to try and rank. Now, you can what we call rank organically, meaning that you don't need to use that PPC anymore, but you use the PPC as a tool to rise up the ranks to the first page, and that will happen much quicker if your price is lower, because the customer will look at yours and the competitions, and they'll go for your one, or they're more likely to because the price is reduced. Now, once you move up organically to that first and second page, you can then move your price back up to your proposed or original price that you were thinking of selling at. We just use this as a tool to be able to create a tremendous volume of sales coming into your listing, which will spike your bestsellers ranking, spike your ranking in general for the search terms that customers are using, and get you to that first page spot, which is our main goal at the beginning. Our main ultimate goal is to do that. You can also use software like Viral Launch, which works very well. You pay a company to actually rank the product for you. They can calculate based on the size of the category and the product and the competition how many sales you're going to need in order to rank and what keywords you're going to rank for, and they just take onus and responsibility for that. If you've got a little bit more capital to do that, you have the option of using software such as Viral Launch to get that done. I personally don't use it. I like to do it myself. But if you have got the additional leeway with your budget and you've got the luxury of doing that, then I would give it a try. Remember also, we're trying to build a brand here. We want ultimately to, again with a private label product, to add to our repertoire of products, make sure that we're adding products every sort of 2 or 3 months if we can to increase your overall revenue and as a result your profits, and build a brand. Bear in mind, once you get a trademark, which is very, very simple to do, you can register within Amazon's brand registry, create a storefront, create a real customer experience for people who are visiting your listing and your store in general. Building a brand, I truly do believe in. I think that if you can successfully build a brand up on Amazon, rather than just looking at it as a money-making scheme, in the long term, you will benefit from that. Ultimately, at the end of this process, once you are generating significant figures from Amazon UK, you may look to stem off of Amazon and actually launch your product on a Shopify or private website, which can prove very, very effective. Again, we can use lots of different methods, Facebook ads, Instagram ads, Google ads, to get traffic to that listing. You won't need customers from Amazon. This is one way that you can look at as a dual source of income. So you have your Amazon FBA business running, and you can link your Shopify website up to FBA as well, so they can fulfill the orders for you. You don't need to post anything like that. You can actually, it's quite clever, the system that you can implement with those two, so that they complement each other very, very well. So that ultimately might be a goal of yours, and in order to do that, you need to build a brand, have a loyal customer base, and make sure that you again have had a customer-centric approach to your whole Amazon FBA business, which will be reflected in your reviews. And again, the brand that you've built, people will trust the business, trust the company, trust the product and the listing that you're selling, and that will be evident through the quality overall of your listing, namely the reviews. So that would be exactly what I focus on there. So finally, taking action, one of the biggest hurdles that most people face with Amazon FBA, and something that once you overcome, you look back on and you kick yourself and think, why didn't I do that sooner? So taking action, I mean going for it, having faith in yourself to be able to do this. You are upskilling yourself now, and you're probably going to continue to upskill yourself to maximize your chances of making this a success. But the hardest part is just taking that first step. Like with anything, once you have, you will never look back. Look at myself, for example. It took me far too long, a number of weeks to be able to move on Amazon FBA. Even though I had a friend who was selling and doing very well, I still found it very difficult. But ultimately, I made the decision, I moved forward with it, and here I am now, 2 years on, having built a six-figure business and quit my job. And it's just unbelievable what you can do in the 21st century just from a laptop and a mobile phone. It's unbelievable. Now, as many of you are aware, I mentioned at the start of this, I am running a UK course and mentorship program, the Amazon FBA Superseller Elite Academy. We have 300 students. Now imagine this fast track tutorial broken down into modulated videos, over 80 videos split up step by step, where I actually demonstrate to you firsthand how to go and do all of these things in, a tremendous amount of detail. Now, as well as that, as well as the course, which is on my website that you have lifetime access to, you also get 4 months mentorship with me personally. So, I have been through my fair share of issues with Amazon FBA, things that, mistakes that I've made that I now will never make again, things that cost me money and just generally a lot of problems. I now help students through the course and the mentorship program, making sure that that doesn't happen. I help students with their product research. I validate product ideas. I can look at listings and critique them and give feedback on how to improve and optimize. And the mentorship, some people only use the mentorship. They're that, it's worth that much, the 4 months mentorship to get a product launched, just in itself is worth the course price. But you also get the full video modulated course with that as well, A to Z, how to sell on Amazon, from product selection, to setting up your business account, to setting up your company, to launching, everything that I know is in there. There's bundles more stuff that's in the course. I'm not gonna go through it all now. The link is below if you want to go and take a look. Like I said, we have a tremendous amount of students who are doing very, very well from the course. You can see their results in the section below where you can visit my website. We've also got student testimonials from students who are doing fantastically well and they vouch for the course and the quality of the course and my mentorship itself. So if you're really serious about this and you wanna give it a go, I can almost guarantee you a good course and mentorship program is the best and most sound investment of all. Because when you look to the future and you cast your mind into where you want to be in 2 years' time, then a small investment now into the proper training and mentorship will pay dividends in the future when you have two or three successful products launched and you have a full-time income from Amazon FBA. So I hope this video was helpful. And I don't know how long it is right now, but I'm hoping it's under 40 minutes. Again, I've shortened it from my last tutorial. We've looked over as much as we can and hope you found it useful. So take action, don't let it fade. Follow me on Instagram, Dylan Reed UK, where I'm documenting my journey as I will continue to do here on YouTube. And yeah, have a fantastic day, everyone. Thank you so much for watching.